Hello and welcome to the fifth and final video in our series, Does Tommy Have Feline Infectious Peritonitis? In this video, we decide what samples to send to a reference laboratory and we work through the list of differential diagnoses of uveitis. Finally, we find out what was wrong with Tommy and what happened to him. This is an educational video for veterinary surgeons and veterinary students and should absolutely not be used by non-veterinarians to try to diagnose their own animals. However, I would like to give a big thank you to all the non-vets out there who are spreading the word about these videos to their veterinary surgeons, and a special thanks to the folks in the FIP Facebook groups who have been great at sharing these videos. We got to the end of step 3 of the FIP diagnostic algorithm with only one definite tick and one tentative tick in the three steps, although step 2 was incomplete. We're attempting to rule FIP in or out of our list of differential diagnoses, and the overall appearance is that FIP is extremely unlikely. This is not unusual. I had a student do a telephone survey of vets who had requested FIP profiles at our diagnostic laboratory at Glasgow Veterinary School, and we found that at least 80% of the cats suspected of suffering from non-effusive FIP turned out to have some other condition. Now we will go through the list of differential diagnoses that we arrived at in the third video of this series. We put together this list of differential diagnoses of uveitis only, not a list of differentials of all the possible clinical signs of a cat with FIP. Those will be dealt with in other videos. First on the list, obviously, was FIP, which Jinks et al. Found to be the cause of around 16% of 120 cats with uveitis in the North Carolina Veterinary School Ophthalmology Referral Service. i.e. FIP is a major cause of feline uveitis, but we've already found that it was unlikely in Tommy's case. Our in-house test was a rapid immunomigration. We could double-check the coronavirus antibody test at the referral laboratory if we doubted the sensitivity of the test or if it had given a ghost line. Next on our list is toxoplasmosis, and here I'd like to remind you of two photos of Tommy from the very first video of the series, clearly showing our bad boy being mean to a little mouse. Thus, we know that he was a hunter and could have eaten an intermediate host of Toxoplasma gondii. Therefore, we will be requesting a toxoplasma antibody test at the referral laboratory. Next on our list is Bartonella henselae, the cat scratch disease organism transmitted by fleas, which has been implicated in feline uveitis, as have other Bartonella species. The difficulty in diagnosing Bartonellosis as a cause of uveitis is the ubiquity of the Bartonella infection. Therefore, getting a positive result can simply be coincidental, and Bartonella may have nothing to do with the clinical signs. Fontenelle et al. Found that antibody testing for B. henselae was not useful for diagnosing Bartonella-related uveitis. Healthy cats were more likely to have antibodies than cats with uveitis. In the Jinx study of 120 cats, antibodies to Bartonella species were found in 43.2% of cases. So how do you diagnose it? Well, two options remain: taking a sample of aqueous humor for PCR testing, or a trial treatment with doxycycline, oxytetracycline, or azithromycin to see if the eye responds to those antibiotics. Therefore, we keep this diagnosis on the list of possibilities, but since Tommy was an older cat and most Bartonella cases are in kittens, and also because most Bartonella infection is subclinical, we'll consider it less likely than other diagnoses. It's not off our list, just lower down, to be tested for later if everything else comes back negative. The most common primary neoplastic cause of uveitis is iris melanoma, followed by trauma-associated sarcoma, while the most common metastatic neoplasia is lymphoma. Since most lymphoma in the cat is secondary to FELV or FIV infection, I've lumped neoplasia, FELV and FIV together, which really isn't correct to do, since FELV and FIV can cause uveitis without neoplasia. However, Tommy was FELV and FIV negative, which doesn't rule out neoplasia, but does make it less likely. And again, it's something we can come back to if we don't come up with a diagnosis. Next on our list we have leishmaniasis, but since Tommy isn't from a sandfly area, we'll say that is ruled out as a diagnosis. Leishmania requires sandfly to transmit it. Trauma. Tommy had had all his teeth removed, but many years ago, so dental instrument trauma was not the cause of his uveitis. In addition, it more usually presents as an eyeball that is absolutely wrecked. Nor was there any sign of injury on the cornea. Therefore, it appeared that the infection had arrived systemically. We've narrowed our list down now, ruling out some items with confidence and leaving a number of things such as Bartonellosis, fungal infection, feline herpes virus, tumour on the back burner to consider if our reference laboratory tests draw a blank. Our next step is to test for antibodies against Toxoplasma gondii, and although FIP is very unlikely, it would give his guardian peace of mind just to know that it was absolutely ruled out. These are his results. His feline coronavirus antibody titer was checked at Glasgow University's Veterinary Diagnostic Services Laboratory, and it was less than 1 in 10, which is considered negative. His alpha-1 acylglycoprotein level was normal. However, he had a high antibody titer for toxoplasma. Remember, in the first video of the series, we saw Tommy with a mouse. I cannot emphasize enough the importance of getting a full and thorough history. Any cat who has access to outdoors, especially in a rural area, has a chance of becoming infected with toxoplasma. Similarly, any animal who gets fed raw meat is at risk of toxoplasmosis, and I include the human animal in this. Guo et al. In their paper stated, Toxoplasma gondii is a protozoan parasite that is responsible for approximately 24% of deaths attributed to foodborne pathogens in the United States. Deaths, not illnesses, deaths from eating raw meat or undercooked meat. The fact that Tommy caught a mouse infected with toxoplasma might not entirely have been by chance. Toxoplasma infection affects the brain and makes rodents more liable to be caught by predators. In their paper, Vias et al. Said, in mice and rats, latent toxoplasma infection converted the aversion to feline odours into attraction. You may be wondering what happened to Tommy. If he had been treated with corticosteroids, toxoplasmosis would have invaded all his organs and he would have died. Since corticosteroids are often used in cases of FIP, I cannot emphasize enough that cats with suspected non-effusive FIP should also be screened for toxoplasma antibodies. Dr. Cohen, a veterinary pathologist, stated, since 2008, the Animal Health Laboratory in Guelph, Canada, has seen 9 cases of extra-intestinal toxoplasmosis, and 8 of these were in young male domestic cats. And many of those cats could have been saved had toxoplasma serology been performed. Dr. Cohen's paper shows a postmortem of an enlarged mesenteric lymph node of one of these cases. Enlarged mesenteric lymph nodes is a fairly common presentation in non-effusive FIP. Happily, Tommy did not end up on Dr. Cohen's pathology table. He was treated with clindamycin, which is the recommended treatment for toxoplasmosis. This shows Tommy in early 2013, 4 years after his presentation. Sadly, in October 2013, his lens luxated and his left eye had to be removed. However, Tommy is alive and well in 2019, at the time of making this video, and 10 years after his illness. If you would like to buy him a can of cat food, you can do so at paypal.me/catvirus. I give an enormous thank you to Dr. Andrew Robertson for giving me Tommy. And I'm very grateful to Dr. John Mould for sharing his photographs and knowledge with me. A link to Dr. Mould's eye clinic in the UK is in the notes below in case you want to refer a case to him. There's also a link below if you wish to obtain a consultation with myself. Many thanks to the catvirus.com subscribers for supporting the website and for keeping it and these videos advertisement free. Thank you for watching these videos. It's been a bit of a long haul and I hope that you feel it was worth it. If so, please like and subscribe. I'm going to finish this video with a tribute to a little cat who was dear to my heart. Thank you. Bye-bye.